So the past few years, we've seen a glut of releases of different action cameras from different manufacturers. And while things have been improving, the image quality is getting better and better all the time. We're now on 8K resolution for some cameras, and we've now got lens attachments for ultra wide views and even anamorphic lenses coming out for these things. But it's been a while since we've seen any real true innovations. I mean, you could say that the ability to use wireless microphones like the one I'm using now with action cameras was an improvement on how things were before, but in terms of really huge new features that would really make you sit up and take notice, we haven't really seen much going on. So what is the future of the action camera now? Will we see any true innovations going forward, or will action camera releases from now on be small iterations on what came before? So bigger sensors are a topic that comes up time and time again, and I've covered this numerous times in previous videos, but still it raises its head year on year as to whether a manufacturer will release a GoPro style action camera with a much larger sensor. So with the release of the DJI Action 6, DJI has pretty much determined that the sensor size on these cameras has reached its maximum limit. If we want to have a very deep hyperfocal distance, that's the closest distance that the camera can focus on all the way to infinity. And the reason why the Action 6 has its variable iris on it is for two reasons. One, so that you can have a very close focus distance to infinity, but also to improve low light as well. So I don't think we're going to see bigger sensors appearing on these cameras unless it is a dedicated camera type. In other words, a camera that has a kind of action camera form factor, but it's actually designed to be used in more general use rather than for action camera use. Now, the inclusion of an iris in the DJI Action 6 does throw up the question of whether you can have an iris that opens up or closes even more. So in other words, a wider iris range. And again, I don't think we're going to see that. There's two reasons for this. Now, it might be possible that the camera gets even faster. In other words, could we see the iris opening up to, I don't know, f1.6 or something like that? But I don't think we're going to see it close down any further, because once you get below f4 on a sensor of that size, you start to see problems of diffraction quite noticeably. So what's diffraction? Well, diffraction is the spreading of light as it passes through a smaller aperture, and the effect is more pronounced at smaller apertures on smaller sensors than it is on larger sensors. But the effect of it is a noticeable softening of the image. So I don't think we're going to see an iris with a particularly wider range on any future action camera. Now, another feature that I have seen come up from time to time is the idea of an optical zoom. But again, I don't think this is realistic to expect because of the complexity that it adds to the lens assembly, particularly in a camera that's going to be used in the sort of situations that an action camera will do. Including optical zoom, particularly if it's an internal zoom, in other words, the lens isn't protruding out of the camera as you go through the zoom range, is very complex, and it would significantly increase the size and the weight of the camera, as well as adding mechanical vulnerability too. Now, you might ask why you can't put something like a periscope zoom on it like they have in some smartphones. And the reason for that is simply that a periscope zoom is long in one dimension, and they also use very small sensors too. So you're either going to have to increase the size of the camera significantly, or you're going to have to sacrifice low light performance as well from having a smaller sensor in order to accommodate such a function. So again, optical zoom, it would be nice, but it's not really practical for an action camera. Now, clearly higher frame rates are always on the cards, and we're likely to see these increase over time as newer sensors are developed. Currently, 120 frames per second in 4K is standardized, but I don't think it's going to be very long until we see something like 240 frames per second in 4K. And that will, of course, allow even higher frame rates in some of the lower resolution modes. And we've already seen that happen with the latest GoPro, which allows burst recording at slow motion frame rates. But either way, we will see higher frame rates come through at some point in the higher resolutions. When that happens, I don't know. But it's one of those features that we kind of expect. So it's not really revolutionary. Now, higher bit rates are also a thing. You can set the GoPro to much higher bit rates than the standard configuration by using the Labs firmware. But the other two flagship cameras on the market, the Ace Pro 2 and the DJI Action Series, you can set a high bit rate, but it's nowhere near what you can get on the GoPro. So having higher bit rates is going to be a very useful thing to have. It's going to be a very practical thing to have, but it's something that really only advanced users care about. And again, it's not a groundbreaking feature simply to have a higher bit rate. So will things move over to 360 cameras? After all, a lot of development is going into these, and in the past year or so, they've become significantly better than previous years. With the introduction of 8K sensors, we can now get useful 4K reframed footage out of these 360 cameras that are available now. And I think going forward, we're going to see a lot more development. We're going to see ever-increasing image quality and easier use as well, because one of the main things with the 360 camera is that you have to reframe the footage afterwards if you're going to edit it into a standard video. But I do think that even if manufacturers make 360 cameras a bit more intuitive to use once you've got the footage back home or on your phone, I still don't see them becoming truly mainstream, because that extra step that you have to take is always going to be an inconvenience. It's adding another step above that of simply just editing the footage together. And technology traditionally succeeds or fails based upon its practicality and ease of use. Personally, I think the big developments in action cameras are going to come about as a result of computational imagery and also audio as well. Now, in terms of computational imagery, I think it would be great to have something like a time of flight sensor in an action camera that records depth information. And that will mean that you can effectively add depth of field effects in post using that depth information or on your phone. Now, Sony has released an ultra tiny time of flight sensor. It released that in April of last year, and it wouldn't necessarily have to record things at the same frame rate as the main camera. You could interpolate the information, so you could have the time of flight sensor working at say 30 frames per second and your camera at 60 frames per second, and it wouldn't be too much of a problem to interpolate that information and then marriage them together. But the wider point is that having some kind of system on these cameras that can effectively record depth information gives you far more flexibility when it comes to editing and creating effects, and also matching up to other cameras in the shoot and getting rid of that action camera look. Now, time of flight sensors are limited in the range that they can accurately detect depth information at, and the further away you want that depth information, the lower the frame rate they work at. So at the moment, I believe that the new Sony sensor can actually go up to 40 meters indoors if you reduce the frame rate down to around 15 frames per second. And then if you increase the frame rate, that distance gets reduced quite drastically. But for an action camera, you would only really need depth information for stuff that's very close to you, because if you wanted to create a shallow depth of field look in post, then you're going to be talking to camera, it's going to be on the end of a selfie stick, or you're going to be holding it in front of you. So having ultra long distance depth sensing wouldn't really be required anyway. Another area that I think needs improving is audio. Now, we can use wireless microphones with action cameras now, and they're very effective. The DJI series of mics is really good, and the Insta360 one is also very good. GoPro has yet to do anything. But these microphones are not waterproof. So one thing that I would really love to see is a fully waterproof wireless microphone. Now, some of you might be shouting at the screen saying I'm being a bit silly because these microphones won't work wirelessly underwater, and that's absolutely correct, but they do often have onboard recording. So I think there'd be a market for one of these microphones that is completely waterproof, can do onboard 32-bit float recording, which can then be seamlessly matched in post. Whichever manufacturer makes such a thing would have to make it so that people who are less technical savvy, when they download the footage onto their phone, the software would need to seamlessly match the audio from the wireless mic to the footage. So there is that hurdle to overcome. But for intermediate and advanced users who might be editing on a laptop or a desktop machine, this wouldn't be a problem, particularly if the video recorded on the camera and the microphone recording had good time code. I would love to record really high quality audio using one of these mics and using that 32-bit float ability. You could place it on various positions on your bike or get much clearer voice audio, or I could mount it in my boat and get more environmental sounds and the sound of the hull hitting the water and that sort of thing. I think it would be really neat to have that ability, but not have to worry about it falling into the water and getting completely destroyed. But keeping with the subject of audio, action cameras are often used for POV. Now, one of the things that I think would be absolutely fantastic to have is some kind of affordable binaural recording system. So, what's a binaural recording system? Well, a binaural audio recording basically simulates how your ears work. A binaural microphone system usually consists of a headset that obviously goes on your head and two omnidirectional microphones which sit just by your ear canal. So they pick up frequencies and sounds in the same way that your ear does. Now, when you play back the recordings, you need to wear headphones in order to get the effect. A binaural audio recording sounds exactly like it would do if you were in the environment yourself. So you can tell the proximity of sounds, you can tell the position of sounds as well. It's a truly immersive audio experience and would work absolutely fantastically with a POV shot from an action camera. But at the moment, binaural microphones are not cheap. One of the only systems that you can buy comes from DPA microphones. It's an amazing system, but it will cost you the best part of a grand. So I think if an action camera manufacturer could make a binaural microphone that was fully waterproof again and also had its own onboard recording system, again in 32-bit float, I think that would be an amazing addition to action cameras and really offer a leap forward in terms of the quality of audio that you can capture with these devices. So those are my ideas about how action cameras can develop going forward. If you've got your own, I'd love to hear about your ideas in the comments below. And if you've watched to the end of this video, thank you very much. And again, if you do like what I do, please do offer me a like and subscribe if you feel very generous. So I'll leave that for now and I'll see you in the next video.